Okay, the today's topic on power system instrumentation, that is EE570 for MTech Electrical third semester is interference effects. This particular PDF I have taken from Carlos University of Madrid, and this has been devised by Pablo Acedo and Jose Garcia Soto. In this particular topic, what we have to discuss, that is the noise and interference that will be present in the instrumentation systems for electronic instrumentation. In electronic instrumentation, power system is also associated. So it is an inevitable fact that whatever I am giving the lecture over here, this noise and interference effect will be present for power system also. Now I am coming to the next slide. We can see over here that if we will be talking about the noise and interference, as I told you before also, noise is an unwanted signal. It is generally random. That's why the statistical mean has to be taken for noise, and that's why the Gaussian curve for that particular probability distribution curve will be coming for noise. Interference is a type of hindrance, but it will be two types. Mainly they are classified into two types. One is constructive interference, one is destructive interference. So here are the things that we will discuss today. First, the introduction. Second, origin of noise in circuits. Third, the noise models. Of course, there are several noise models for amplifiers. Fourth one, examples of calculation of noise limited resolution in signal conditioning circuits. Fifth one, interference, sources of coherent interference. Sixth one, minimization of interference effects. Seventh one, ground loops. And the last one will be in the form of summary. So now I will go to the next one. Just see, in the introduction it has been told that both the noise and interference, of course their origin may be different, but they provide a major limitation to the precision of measurements and the detectability or resolution. Of course, why it will be providing a major limitation? Because whenever we will detect some parameter value after experimentation, that means the experimental value, there will be some change, some error will be present with this. That's why it has been told over here that both noise and interference, although their origin will be different, but they will provide a major limitation. Now just see over here, it is being told that the different origins for electronic noise that is present with electronic instruments, of course for power system also, and coherent interference leads to different approximation when trying to reduce their effects, because we have to minimize the effects of both noise as well as interference so that we will get one optimized value. So we have to do approximations. Important part is this: although systemization of the noise and coherent interference influence is available, and a brief discussion follows, of course it will come after that, in real system experience of the designers is critical, because how to manage these effects which will come from noise as well as interference so that there will be an optimum design that should be possible for every electronic instrument in power system. Because sometimes it will be impossible to account or to just face the problems related to or the problems that will originate from all these types of noise and interference which will lead to the error in the design. Now if I will come into the next slide, you can see over here origins of noise in circuits. You can see over here noise actually it is a random phenomena. Of course it will be thermal noise, as we are knowing that noise can be of two types. It may be of thermal noise, it may be of quantum origins. You can see over here that it may be considered that noise sources to be stationary and with zero means. That means they are not, suppose they are not changing their position, but then also they will create disturbance in the problem. The latter means that the unwanted DC components, please remember the DC components, because the mean is zero, and are best considered to be drifts or offsets. Drifts means what? If there will be some deviation in the value, offset is what? Whenever there will be some changes in the value, there will be some deviation, we will have to do some corrective measure adjustment, that is known as offset, and their influence are to be treated separately. Of course, whatever be the influences related with drifts and offsets, that we have to measure. Now coming to this one, the characterization of noise sources is usually done in terms of power density. Of course, power density is a very important thing. Suppose in this case we have to consider about a sphere in which the system is designed. Now we have to find out in every point of that sphere what should be the power density, and that is why that particular thing is dependent on frequency also. That is why this F is coming over here. And of course, whenever we are talking about power, it should, or power density, power means its unit will be what? Power density means with respect to frequency we are measuring how. So that's why it is written over here S of N. That means every single point within the sphere we are considering what? Per hertz. And it is defined at the Fourier transformation of the autocorrelation function of the noise. As we are knowing before, from the analog as well as digital communication as well as mobile communication also, in the undergraduate courses, autocorrelation and cross-correlation function of the noise. So now I am not going to explain that particular thing over here, but this is very important thing, that power density, in the power density spectrum we have to find out the Fourier transform, and that is related with the autocorrelation function of the noise. And we are knowing this term also, that there will be white noise or colored noise. White noise we are knowing that when this value Sn of f with respect to frequency, if it is constant over a particular range of frequency, then we will talk about the white noise. Now I am coming to the next slide. In this next slide we can see over here, if we will consider about the thermal noise or Johnson noise, because all these things we learned in analog communication also. You can see over here again Sn of f, that means again the power density which is dependent on frequency. Moreover, it is, of course, that's why the unit is watt per hertz. Moreover, it is depending on two important things. One is the temperature in Kelvin. You can see over here T is written. And one more thing over there, that is this value of K. K is nothing but Boltzmann constant. So all these things will be accumulated, or all these things will be taken into account when we will consider about thermal noise or Johnson noise. And whenever we are talking about voltage noise, whenever we will measure voltage, maybe there will be some unwanted signal will be present. So Vn of f, again the same thing will be coming over here, but in some different form. You can see over here, as because we are finding the root mean square value of the voltage, because we are considering noise over here, that's why that statistical interpretation will be coming over there, and it is being taken with respect to the frequency, and frequency will be in this form, under root hertz to the power square. So you can see over here in this and in this equation only one thing is different, one R or resistance term is introduced over here. Now this thermal noise is white, and it is the main source of noise in electronic circuits. That means it is constant over a band of frequency. Now if I will come into the next slide for origin of noise in circuits, then we will come to quantum noise. As we told before also, it can be electronic noise or quantum noise. Electronic noise mainly we can see in the form of thermal noise or Johnson noise. Thermal noise can be also being classified into white noise and colored noise. Now I am coming to this short or quantum noise. Now this is associated to DC currents. This short or quantum noise is associated to DC currents, and it is through potential barriers. We are knowing from PN shunt diode that in one side there will be P type, one side there will be N type. That means P type, P block will be one side, N block will be other side. In between there will be depletion region or barrier potential, and whenever we will complete this circuit by attaching one particular voltage supply, then there will be conduction of current through the circuits. Now just see over here, appears mainly in light detection, short noise limit, and in active devices as transistors. We are knowing that transistor is an active device, which is a self-energizing device for which auxiliary power supply of course needed, but it is in, you can say this is an active device because it can be triggering itself for further action. You can see over here ISN, that means now we are going for n number of points within the sphere compared to calculated with respect to frequency, and now as we are considering the DC current, so IDC is coming over here. Q is nothing but the charge associated with this, and again there we are finding for DC voltage VRMS, here for current A is just giving you an idea of ampere. Of course RMS value of current we have to measure it over here with respect to frequency. Now short noise is also white for all frequencies of interest in instrumentation. It is very important if this quantum noise in constant over a band of frequency, then it can be termed as white noise also. Now again, one more thing, just see over here, flicker. This is a very important thing. Flicker is actually what? Flicker is depending on inverse of frequency. Flicker noise, flickering noise we are talking about. Suppose we are measuring some particular parameter over digital panel meter or digital voltmeter, and there will be fluctuations in the values with respect to time, because every instrument will be having some systematic error. There will be loading effect present with every type of system, irrespective of power system or electronic system or electrical system or mechanical system or computer system or biotechnology system, as well as there will be transient and steady state. Until and unless the steady state will be arrived or achieved, there will be flicker or flicker noise present in the system. You can see over here it is written associated to DC currents through resistances, and it is a colored noise of relevance. That means now it is not constant within the frequency band. This noise value is changing within the frequency band, and that is why it is only possible at low frequencies. One remarkable example is of CRO. If we will consider for CRO the DC voltage or DC current at lower frequencies, say from 10 Hz to 50 Hz or 50 Hz to 90 Hz, we can see, or up to 100 Hz, we can see flickering over there, but after that disturbances over there, but after that that disturbance will be stabilized and we will get stable waveform, either continuous or exponential type of waveform. So now we are considering this thing again with respect to frequency, we are considering the voltage value, but now we are considering two terms, again voltage RMS with respect to frequency in one term, KTR, 4 KTR is coming, R is nothing but the resistance, pure resistance related with the circuit, T is nothing but the absolute temperature, K is nothing but the Boltzmann's constant, I square A, I square F, it is nothing but actually whatever we are considering a particular type of current that will be driven through the circuit to maintain it into the operating condition with respect to frequency. Now this thing is very important. This is a random error because the value of noise, it will be changing erratically. It is not white noise, it is a quantum noise, or you can say it is a type of flicker. The flicker noise is a type of quantum noise. Always the value is being changing, and that's why we have to find out the standard deviation and variance, because random errors will be there. Now one more thing is coming over here, crossover frequency. It is very important thing. Crossover frequency means this is a frequency at which the flicker spectral noise density, that means SN of F for flicker noise, the flicker spectral or the flicker noise spectral density will be equal with the white noise spectral density. That particular frequency is known as crossover frequency, because after that frequency, of course, spectral density for flicker noise and white noise will be different from each other. Now, it is usually given in total peak-to-peak voltage over a given bandwidth. Why do we going for peak-to-peak voltage? Because peak-to-peak voltage will give us the idea about the exact amplitude, maxima and minima values. That's why from in the, or we can say that's why in the higher frequency range, when we will get the continuous waveform, we are going in a bandwidth, the sine, or we will get in a bandwidth the sinusoidal or triangular or square waveform, but that is a stable, you can say that is the continuous type of waveform. Of course I should not use the word stable, because it will go up to an infinite time, that is depending on our choice. Now noise models in amplifiers. As we can see over here, here is a voltage supply. This is what? This is actually an alternating voltage supply. Here is another alternating voltage supply. This is the current source. This current source, of course, this is the independent current source. In between there are two resistors present over here. Similarly, whatever voltage drop we will get over here, we are measuring it over here. And in this side also, there is another voltage source with this another resistor is connected, and here we will get the voltage drop. You can see over here, noise sources inside an amplifiers are multiple, and it is impossible to address them separately, because whenever one particular signal will be amplified, that will be audible to us. If at all there will be noise sources inside the amplifier, it will be very difficult to separate them, because that crossover frequency where the spectral density of flicker noise as well as the spectral density of white noise, it is for a range of time period. In that particular time period, it is completely impossible to separate those two noises or separate each and every single constituent of total noise that will be present inside an amplifier. Thus, you can say a model including only equivalent voltage, whatever we are presenting over here, and current noise sources are the input is used. You can see over here, this is for this one, you can see this is the current source. Why current noise sources? Because we are assuming that noise is associated with it similarly we are using one equivalent voltage source over here, and thus we can take out this thing into feature, take out this thing into our feature, then there will be an equivalent. As these two are in parallel, so we will multiply both of them to get the voltage with that the resistance will be in series. Now just see, only white contribution, that means thermal and short noise, are usually taken into account. That means we will take into account the Johnson noise and the short noise. We will not going in the detail of quantum noise. Now if I will come to this, noise limited resolution. What is resolution? Resolution is a particular type of property when there will be an infinitesimal change in the input, there will be change in the output in accordance to the input. So the output will be just responding in the same way when there will be change in the input. You can see over here, there is an inverting amplifier present over here. The non-inverting terminal is being grounded. With the inverting terminal, one alternating voltage supply is present. There is the input resistance, there is the feedback resistance. With the input resistance, one more voltage supply is present over here, and here we are getting at terminal number 6 of normal operational amplifier MUA741A the output voltage. Now we are calculating the signal power and the noise power. Of course, whenever we will calculate the signal power as well as noise power, we are knowing this formula very well. V equal to what? V equal to I into R. Power equal to what? Power is equal to volt into ampere. We can write that volt into ampere like this. I into R into I. So it will be I square R. Or I square, we can write it like this, V square by R square into R. So that same thing is written over here. VRMS is present over here, V source is present over here. This is for V source. VRMS, of course, as we are considering the noise, VRMS is coming over here. RF is present over here, R1 is present over here, which is R1 is nothing but the input side resistance. So now we are getting the signal power by the use of this formula. Similarly with the noise power, if we have to consider, then we have to again take all those features in our calculation. Just see this particular type of thing. As we are seeing over here for flicker noise, and just see this one. This is for short noise or quantum noise, and just see this one. This is for white noise as well as thermal noise. So taking all these things into account, we are coming to this calculation for noise power where both the feedback resistance, input resistance, Boltzmann constant and absolute temperature in Kelvin, we have taken all those things. As because we can go for non-inverting, this is for inverting terminal. This is the previous one which is present when there will be actually white noise. This is the position when there will be crossover frequency, and this is for, this portion is generally for non-inverting type, because for non-inverting type also there may be possibility of noise origin. BW bandwidth we are giving over here, over a certain bandwidth of frequency we are getting this RMS voltage that will be multiplied with current. Now coming to next slide, signal to noise ratio. This ratio should be optimized. If this ratio is not optimized, as we can see over here, this is the noise value. This will be coming in the denominator. This is the signal that will be coming in the numerator. So now if I will just divide this thing, so this thing will be gone, as because it is not equal to zero. So in the next slide, let us see what we are getting. We are getting like this. So now for example, let us take the input resistance is of 1 kilo ohm, the feedback resistance is of 100 kilo ohm. Of course, we are knowing the value of Boltzmann constant. Let us take the 4 kT value as 1.66 into 10 to the power minus 20 watts per hertz, because with respect to frequency we are doing this calculation. Let us also take the voltage value as 10 nanovolt per root of hertz. Let us also take the bandwidth as 200 kilohertz. And after doing all these considerations, we are getting the signal to noise ratio, the ideal value as unity for minimum source voltage of 6.7 microvolt, or you can say 6.7 into 10 to the power minus 6 volt. Now coming to the next slide, if we will go, just see resolution in photocurrent measurement. If we will do for photocurrent, photocurrent means of course, if there will be some source related to solar power, if there will be some source related to optical type of measurement, then this will be the thing. You can see over here the voltage supply, with that the diode is connected in reverse bias, with that an inverting terminal is connected, that means with the anode and inverting terminal is connected, in between there will be one feedback resistance, so there will be the conduction of current and voltage drop will be present over here, as well as over here whatever voltage drop will be present over here, that we are finding as voltage drop in the output terminal. The non-inverting terminal is grounded over here. If we will do this, the equivalent circuit, how it is working over here, then we can come to this, that you can see over here there are two independent current sources which is in parallel with the resistance, which is further in parallel with another independent current source. There is one voltage, alternating voltage source present over here, and there will be this feedback resistance present over here. Of course, all of them will be present for a band of frequency. Ultimately, there will be the output. So just see over here, input voltage noise of the amplifier has a flicker component. Always there will be a flickering of 0.18 microvolt peak to peak. That is from one peak to another peak, the value, all total value will be of 1.18 voltage. And this is in 10 hertz of bandwidth. This is very important thing, and whenever we will put those value, whenever we have to find out that particular voltage value which is drop, which is getting in at the output region with respect to frequency, we will again use this formula over here. Here one thing very important, that is the B parameter, as it is being written over here. The input voltage noise of the amplifier has a flicker component of 0.18 microvolt peak to peak, that is 0.1 to 10 hertz, that means within this bandwidth, and it is used for V parameter calculation. This V value will be coming over here, and with that we will do this calculation. Coming to the next slide, again noise limited resolution. Again we are using the signal power, again we are using the noise power, and let us suppose if one particular resistance is tending towards infinity, and if the B value is written like this, and if we will take for our example all these values, like this is the feedback resistance, it is actually 10 to the power 4 megawatt. Or you can say it is 10 giga, this is actually 10 to the power 4 mega ohms, or you can say 10 giga ohms. Then you can see over here, that means this is the current that will be drawn through the circuit. This is the femtoampere, 0.2 femtoampere per unit of root hertz. 4 kT value, of course it is unchanged, it is given over here. Q is the charge, 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. VNA, corresponding that value is coming in nanovolt per unit of root hertz, and bandwidth of 2 hertz. If we will put all these values with this approximation, that is the V value is of 8.8 into 10 to the power minus 16 V square, and if RPD, you can see over here, RPD is present over here. If this is tending towards infinity, then we will get the value of signal to noise ratio as 1, and the current, minimum current that will be drawn to the circuit will be 1.8 picoampere, that means 1.8 into 10 to the power minus 12 ampere. Coming to the next slide, interference sources. Now if we will consider about the coherent signals that will be coming from other system, it may be possible that it may be present within the circuit itself, that will enter to any system. Although coherent means same, that means one particular source, from one particular source for which the center will be, or says different sources for which the center point will be same. Now it is telling that although from coherent origin and thus narrow band, and they are better treated as random signals and errors. I am telling repeatedly that random signals and errors will be much more in the lower frequency range compared to higher frequency range. In opposition to the noise, interference are external signal, because it may possible that noise is present within the instrument, but interference we are imposing from the outside also. For this reason, the best way to minimize this effect is to identify the interference parts to our circuits or system, because if it is the external, then we can stop it or we can minimize it up to a certain extent. But as because noise, it is very much difficult, as we can see over there, for noise amplifier, it is being present within the system in a crossover frequency, while the spectral density of flicker noise and white noise, both of them are equal. Now we can identify four major paths for interference. What are those? One is signals coupled in inputs and outputs. Second one is capacitive coupling. Third one is magnetic coupling. And fourth one is RF coupling. So we can use any of these four, or if we can tell that these four major paths are present for interference. If I will come to the next slide, minimization. How we can minimize the interference, coherent interference that will be often present in the system? We have to follow the laws of physics and circuit theory. First, we have seen over there, there will be capacitive coupling. So avoid the direct capacitive coupling between signals tracks. That means if there will be direct coupling of the voltage source with the capacitance, avoid that. Using ground planes and guard rings, of course, that will bypass the effect. Avoid magnetic coupling, avoiding loops. Use twisted pair. If we will use twisted pair of things, of course we can avoid the magnetic coupling. Protecting power supply inputs with feed throughs. That means we have to use feed through and feedback system just to avoid interference signal paths through supply voltages. Of course, that should be present over there. And use shielding to avoid RF coupling. Radio frequency coupling is much more dangerous, so we have to avoid that RF coupling when necessary. Coming to next slide, this is actually the figure of instrumentation amplifier when it is coupling with the amplifier. We can see over here, this is the wrong thing. The instrumentation amplifier is directly in connection with the amplifier. Terminal number 6 is directly connected with the amplifier, but it is the wrong thing. Why wrong thing? Because if the noise will be amplified over here, and again if it will be going to the next circuitry, and again we are measuring what will be the voltage drop across the load, it will be a loss type of things. That means we cannot do, of course we can do the experiment, but we cannot get the exact result. That's why we have to do whatever over here. That means this feedback, just see this feedback path we are using, and then we are connecting here. We are just attaching both the terminal, that means both the terminal number 7 directly to terminal number 1 over here, that means AD converters. But here we are connecting this as feedback, and again we have feedback over here. So coming to next slide, this is actually the figure of ground loops where we are using actually what we can say type of shield just to avoid the RF coupling over here. Here also we are using different type of RF shield just to avoid the coupling. So these things are very important whenever we have to pass through direct capacitive coupling, magnetic coupling, RF coupling, as I have seen over here. As I told you over here, that signals coupled in inputs and outputs, capacitive coupling, magnetic coupling and RF coupling, just to counter all those things we are doing these approximations. And now just see what we are doing over here. Use separate grounds for digital or analog signals. You can see over here analog signal 1, analog signal 2, digital signal 1, digital signal 2, motors, relays, then power supply. Of course for all of them the ground will be same. You can see this. Of course we are using the ground. That means only one point to ground the circuit system, but there will be separate ground. That means all those separate ground will be accumulated to one point, and moreover use separate power supply when possible. We have to use this shield case as I told you before over here also, the shield case. So what is the summary? Both noise and interference, though of different origin, provide a major limitation to the precision of measurements and the detectability or resolution. We have presented the main sources of noise in signal conditioning circuits. Of course, whatever all those approximations we have seen over there for thermal noise or Johnson noise, for white noise, for short noise, for quantum noise, their signal conditioning circuit. An example of its treatment in order to obtain the noise limited resolution of the measurement circuit by signal to noise ratio. For every time we have to calculate for voltage, every time voltage power, every time we have to calculate for noise power, then we have to find out the ratio. Remember always it will be in watt per unit of hertz under root. Main paths for interference signal have also been identified, and some guidance to minimize the interference effect due to their importance. Ground loops should be treated separately. There should be one point of interaction for the ground, but for every one of them ground loops should be different to one another so that there will be no coupling. So here I end my particular thing about the interference effect for noise. Thank you very much.